78% of IT roles now require AI-related skills, but enterprises face critical shortages in expertise for AI ethics, security, and large language model oversight. My name is Paul Nashawaty. I'm the practice lead for the AppDev practice, and I'm joined by Saurabh. Saurabh, how are you doing?
Good, thanks. How are you?
Great to have you on. This is a super important topic. Why don't you introduce yourself and introduce your company?
For sure, yeah. I'm the distinguished AI researcher at Vectra AI. We're a cybersecurity company that protects modern networks, where we have a detection and response platform that we use to basically detect malicious behaviors and attackers in your network in a manner that helps you stop attacks before they've really escalated.
Well, Saurabh, really great to have you on today. In this episode today, we're talking about the rapid evolving world of AI and the critical role humans play in overseeing these powerful technologies. When I say that, I'm not minimizing the fact that AI is a powerful technology. It takes a lot for things to happen, which also means that there's a lot of bad actors out there too. So we're going to look into these and explore these emerging threats like Slop squatting and the reliability of AI and automation, and why keeping humans in the loop is more important now more than ever. So great to have you here. I want to ask you a question. When we look at starting at the new oversight roles are emerging, we see that LLMs are handling more generation, and the human role becomes one of more of an oversight piece and looking at vetting and testing and interpreting code. What are these new skills and what's demanding these new skills as AI is really becoming more as a critical part of these equations?
Yeah, so it's interesting to note that like AI, machine learning, and in particular in the domain of, security or app development or, something like that, traditionally 5-10 years ago, these models were used in very particular ways with very narrow scope. But with the advent of LLMs and the sort of explosion of GenAI, you have models that are far more capable and have sort of more far-ranging skill sets or capabilities, right? And so people are using them in ways that are totally new. And a lot of this is both, on the one hand, really incredible capabilities that you can unlock, but also, as you mentioned, they're fallible, right? So LLMs should not simply be trusted to do a thing correctly. And so there's a lot of new workflows and design patterns that are sort of people are experimenting with and, inventing on the fly as they're, understanding what things work, what things don't work, how, you want to design with an LLM either as your co-pilot or trying to automate, the process of coding completely.
Yeah, it is an important competitive advantage for organizations to keep, moving faster, using, pushing code out the door and interpreting the code and testing and vetting. But it also does mean that there's, potentials for challenges and things to happen that, are probably undesirable, right? And that's what we want to make sure that we're kind of watching for here. So I mentioned up front, it's the term slop squatting, right? It's a it's a new kind of a term that's being discussed and used, and it really is a way to majorly exploit techniques, right, that allow for the LLMs to invent plausible sounding but fake name packages, or the kind of attackers use these things to upload malicious versions and such, but without package authentication and such and the checks, the risk will grow at rapid speeds. This is a big problem what we're seeing, especially as, again, organizations are trying to move very quickly at pushing code out the door. We're seeing in our own research that 24% of organizations are trying to push their new applications out the door on an hourly basis. Those speeds are fast. So when we look at this, what does this mean to, this whole slop squatting thing? What does it mean to the overall environment?
Yeah, I think slop squatting is interesting in particular because it sort of gives you a sense of how these models operate and how to think about, where you integrate them into your workflow, right? So LLMs at the end of the day, putting aside how remarkable they are, they're autocomplete models. They generate things that superficially sort of feel like the kind of thing that you would output or generate in response to some query or input or question or whatever. And so slop squatting happens when, for example, the LLM might be asked to write an algorithm that does, you know, X, Y, and Z, and it'll invent or, you know, make a completely plausible sounding sort of package, and it'll tell you to import that package. Now, if you're an enterprising attacker, you might say, hey, I'm going to go before anyone puts up on, you know, any of these like NPM, PyPy, or whatever, I'm going to put up a package that basically takes that name and incorporates some sort of malicious, you know, backdoor behavior, whatever. And so slop squatting is interesting because it shows you the kinds of things that developers, AI researchers, whatever, you never had to really think about this sort of attack before, but it's a completely new and sort of unexpected attack vector that's appeared because of what LLMs are and what they're doing. I'd add one more sort of important point to make is that slop squatting is an interesting case where, yes, this is an attack vector, but there are going to be numerous types of bugs, you know, exploits or whatever that basically emerge from people not understanding what these models are truly capable of doing, how they should be used, and so on. Right. So anyone who's done some vibe coding or spec driven development, it's remarkable. You sit down, you know, ask an LLM to write me. I don't know, for example, how to write an app for an iPhone. Never done it before. But with, you know, some of these tools in hand, ChatGPT, Cursor, Cloud Code, I can develop my own applications, right? And then push them without having any idea if these things are secure. Have I done things optimally? Have I architected, you know, things in the right
way? Yeah, I don't know if I necessarily feel confident in doing that. I mean, I know that I was using, AI tool to help me generate an image the other day, and it was making up all sorts of words that I had no idea what those words meant. So I'm not sure I really want to trust it at this point to just push code out the door.
Yeah, no, for sure. And there is, you know, everyone will tell you have to review the code that these models will generate.
Absolutely.
And there are even ways to sort of build pipelines and, you know, multi-agent systems where, you know, one agent is going to write the code, another agent will write unit tests, and da-da-da-da-da-da. But there's still this, like, the inclination, it tells me, here's the code that does it. I know I should read it. I know that's the right thing to do, but people are going to get, you know, they're going to fall into sort of lazy behaviors and patterns. And it's going to, I think, lead to serious security issues and serious jankiness in the kinds of apps that are developed ultimately.
I couldn't agree more. I think people are going to become ultra dependent and not and almost overly confident in areas that they shouldn't. So that leads us to the next question, really. When you look at AI trustworthiness, is it really enough for that hands-off end-to-end automation? Are we really going to allow, maybe not now, but maybe in the future, but allow for AI that depends on error likelihood or state failures or potential benefits of full automation? All that fits within the AI, but like, is it ready? Can you bring me?
I think the real risk is that it's sufficiently good that it will convince people that it's ready, right? Like you can use ChatGPT and think, I've written apps with no knowledge of how to do so for an iPhone, for example, that it runs, it does the thing, or seemingly does the thing, right? And so it's very easy to convince yourself, this is good, this is doing what I want it to do. And so I think the real risk, the real danger is actually that it's just good enough that people will trust it, but not sufficiently good that it should be trusted, right? So that in between, not quite there, but you know, it's sufficiently ready that people are going to use it. That's where the real risk lies, I think.
Yeah, I just think that it's important for the audience to understand that, you know, you have to double check and triple check. There's a belts and suspenders model here. Is, you know, keep in mind that whatever you use these tools for, whatever the tool is, you're still, you need to be accountable. You need to be responsible for what you're putting out the door. So, you know, with that said, I think I'd like to understand, and maybe from your perspective, what would you tell the audience here on best practices to keep humans in the loop when there's so much that's driving about keeping, you know, maybe a full automation? Many AI-driven tools today still operate in a co-pilot model, rather, you know, assistant rather than replacing human decisions, but yet there's this desire to move to full automation. What's your thoughts here?
I think it all comes down to understanding and experimentation, right? So understand how these models work, what they should and should not be used for. I believe that actually, if you choose narrow slices of things to automate, behaviors to automate, there are places where you can deploy LLMs and, you know, these advanced GenAI systems. Again, multi-agent systems with, if you've orchestrated and architected things correctly, you can create these robust feedback loops so that you can error correct and sort of, you know, design a system that basically carries out a task end to end. Again, these tend to be in limited fashion. I think the other general principle that I've really sort of attached to or find myself really enamored by is this idea of defensive UX. If you're building LLMs or AI into your product, into your apps, into your whatever workflows, do so in a way that if they fail, it's not going to be catastrophic. Do so in a way that basically, you know, the worst case scenario is actually, you know, not terribly harmful.
Yeah, that I like that. That's good guidance, good best practice. But let's also ask the question, because I mean, I think there's kind of a number of ways to look at this. Who should have the power to reverse AI decisions? Should it be everyone that's using it? Should it be that only certain people that put it through that governance model? There's a lack of regulatory frameworks that really raise the important questions about governance, accountability, and ethical implications of AI during decisions. This is a big problem within a lot of organizations. So who should be the decision maker here? Should it be the person using the tool? Like, so if I'm using a hammer and I put a nail in the wall, you know, like, you know, is it my responsibility or is it somebody else's responsibility?
Yeah, that's a fantastic question. And it's incredibly difficult right now, in particular, because it's easy enough for any employee at a company to download or to sign up for ChatGPT or to get any access to any of these tools and just start incorporating it into their workflows, right? I think, first of all, I'll point out that I don't think that the policy frameworks exist in a way that, like, you know, regulatory mechanisms are really robust and, you know, there in a way that would actually govern or secure AI's usage, either from an ethical perspective or even from a pure, like, you know, efficacy or correctness or robustness perspective. But I do think within your organization, one of the models we've followed, and it's sort of been developed, we've developed this in tandem with some partners at AWS, Amazon AWS, but creating a sort of cross-organizational sort of what we've called a center of excellence, or, you know, interest group for Gen AI and LLMs. And we're effectively, experimenting and determining what things make sense and what things don't make sense, what should be allowed and what shouldn't be allowed, given the types of security considerations, PII, IP that we have in place at our company. I think something like that is likely to be a good model for a broad range of organizations, companies, institutions. So finding stakeholders who are going to be both interested in and responsible for the usage of AI, and having them sit down and ultimately work through some of the implications and policy considerations.
I think that makes a lot of sense. I also think you could take into consideration the external factors, like think of things like the EU CRA or the governance and control regulations and executive orders that are in place. All of these things have ramifications if you break these things, like the NIST controls and such that are out there. If you don't follow these things to the T, then you end up having, you end up having potentially fines and reputation. But not only just those things, you could actually serve jail time if things are not done properly and correctly. So there's a lot to think about here. But Saurabh, when we think about this topic, and you know, we introduced a lot here, and there's a lot of people on this journey, right? A lot of organizations are trying to figure out what to do, right? And some organizations are very well kind of throughout their journey and they're very mature. Other organizations are just getting started. Where would you advise the audience here listening to us? Where would you advise them to go to learn more about what we're talking about?
It's interesting. For folks that are interested in actually becoming practitioners, making use of AI, I think ultimately looking for resources, tutorials, courses that basically will walk you through the application of LLMs or GenAI to types of problems that you're looking into. For stakeholders and potentially interested parties looking to make use of AI at your organization, I think trying to seek out essentially, like you mentioned, you know, there are increasingly going to be governance documents and policies and executive orders and so on that try and shape and nudge the usage of AI. I think finding those will be useful in determining what you're comfortable with and what you need to adhere to. And then last, I would say, it's interesting, the field of artificial intelligence moved so quickly that, you know, it's no longer the case that academic journals were, you know, sufficient to like stay on top of what's state of the art. So things move to conferences, and then from conferences, things move to basically, you know, you could find it's the conference publishing cycle was, you know, you don't want to wait 6 months. Let's just put it on archive, right? This, academic paper publishing site. But now actually sites like Twitter, Blue Sky, and things like that are quite good for getting, you know, a sense of, you know, what people are doing, how people are experimenting with AI and incorporating into their workflow. So I think actively going out, try and find what other folks in your domain, in your area are doing. And that'll always be a good start.
Well, you offer up some great advice, Rob. I really appreciate you joining us today on this conversation. It's a really important conversation. It's definitely an area that's top of mind for many, many organizations. I also want to give a big thanks to all of you who tuned in. We really appreciate you being part of the AppDevANGLE community. But for now, that wraps up this episode. But we'll be back next Wednesday with another conversation diving into the tools, trends, and talents shaping the future of application development. So whether you're deploying at the edge, building with AI, or modernizing your cloud stack, we have you covered. But be sure to follow us on social if you have any thoughts, questions, or just want to connect. Until next time, stay curious and stay building.